Okay, I think we're ready. Jeff, I think we're ready to go for week two.
Okay. How's it going, folks? Let's see. Last week, the first thing we did was tune, and so it's still probably a good idea to get us all in tune, even though obviously we can't hear each other. That was weird. even if we can't hear each other, we still obviously want everything to sound good. So, I'm going to start off and play the sixth string, and then we talked about how to use these little tuners last time. The tuner will tell you what note you're playing. It should say E-A-D-G-B-E. That's from the sixth string, which is the one closest to me, the big string, all the way down to the first string, which is also E. And we mentioned that the there's a little sentence where the first letter of each word tells you the name of the actual string, the letter name of each string, or the note name of each string. Eddie ate dynamite, goodbye, Eddie. So when I play my sixth string, it should tell me that I'm playing an E. And when I play the fifth string, it should say A. And the fourth string is D. The third string is G. The second string is B. And the first string is E. Now, I went through that really quick because we're going to actually show you another way to tune, because inevitably, sooner or later, the batteries go dead on these things, and unless you're really super prepared to have like a supply of them, you know, it's like the batteries are dead. And everybody's like, well, how can I tune my guitar if my tuner doesn't work? And we showed you can get some for your phone. The phone apps work, but everybody else in the room has to be totally silent because it's picking it up through a microphone. So anyway, there's another way we can tune the guitar, and it's called what a lot of people call tuning by ear, which is what we kind of did last week when I played the note for you, and then you had to match your pitch at home with my notes. It was sort of tuning by ear, but what if you don't have another guitar player? What if it's just you all by yourself? Well, the first thing we need to do is make sure that the sixth string is in tune to an E note. And for example, I obviously have a tuner here to do this, but there's many other places you can go for an E. It's sort of funny, but you can almost pick any Metallica song, even if you don't like Metallica, just put their music on and play away on your sixth string, and almost all Metallica songs are, I shouldn't say almost all, but it is kind of funny that many of them have E as a fairly prominent note. So, for example, if they were doing, Nothing Else Matters, right? That first note you hear there is the sixth string E. So you can play your sixth string E along with the beginning of that song and sort of get it in tune by listening to the actual recording. quite a few other ones, too, like Enter Sandman. That note's a big part of it. So, anyway. A Metallica CD works really, really well for tuning. Once you have that string in tune, the next thing we're going to do is do what we call relative tuning. Now, you guys can, I would encourage everybody to know this, but also to like write it down or whatever, because it is kind of the secret to being able to tune. If you don't have a tuner, and you don't have another guitar, you don't have anything, you just have to tune by yourself. So I'm going to play the sixth string. Like I said, that's E. This time I'm going to play it at the fifth fret. Now, for those of you who have little dots or position markers on your guitar, there are position markers at 3, 5, 7, and 9. And then there's one with two dots. That's fret number 12. We're going for number 5, which is right here. Now, not everybody has one at fret 1. I think the Yamaha company, sometimes their guitars don't have a dot at fret 3. Some guitars are real, real fancy and have like a inlay or something at fret 1. But regardless, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, this is the one we're going for. And like I said, on the side of your guitar, there's also little dots that'll tell you where you are. So I'm going to play the sixth string at fret 5. And that's that name of that note is A, and that's actually the same as your open fifth string. And when those two strings are in tune, they should sound like the same note. Now, there's a couple things that I sort of try to point out to people when I do this, is I have to let both notes overlap one another. I have to play this note and let it ring while I play the other one so that I can actually compare it with my ear. And I'm going to show you what it sounds like when it's out of tune in a second. But I can compare those two notes. But if I only hear one at a time, it's a little harder. It's not impossible, but definitely a little harder. Also, if I play them both at the same time, it's hard to distinguish one from the other, like this. I can't really tell which one's which. It's kind of, you know, kind of weird. So I want to play one at a time like that. And I want to let them ring so I can compare them one against another. Now I'm going to take this string and I'm just made it totally out of tune. And then you can hear, now that I can tell like which one, that's pretty out, right? So the other thing that's kind of tricky about this as far as hearing things is obviously the note that I'm actually fretting here at the fifth fret. That string sounds a little bit bigger and darker sounding, and the other one sounds a little bit brighter and twangier, in addition to having a pitch difference. So what we're really listening for is the actual note that you would actually sing to match those notes. We're not really listening to the tonal quality of the note. Variety of reasons scientifically they sound different. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold that note, and I can say, well, that note's lower. And as I get closer to being in tune, you'll hear the notes. There's this little wobbling sound that maybe you'll be able to tell. And as I get pretty close to being in tune, that wobbling gets real, real slow until I say, okay, that sounds like it's in tune. Now, As I tune my guitar, it's all relative to the previous string. So I want to make sure that all of them, I can get them as close as possible. But at the same time, I don't really want to agonize over it and lose sleep, because if I do that, I'm going to, you know, my guitar will never be in tune, because I'll just kind of keep going back and saying, oh, I don't like that, I don't like that. So sooner or later, you kind of have to say, that works. Next, I go to the fifth string. This is the Eddie 8 string. And I'm going to play that at the fifth fret. That's a D note, just like Eddie 8 Dynamite. So that's a D. The fourth string's D. And again, I can adjust that. One note's going to be a little bit duller sounding. One's going to be a little bit brighter sounding. But we're listening for the pitch difference, not the tone quality. Then I go to the fourth string and I play fourth string D. I'm going to play that at the fifth fret, which is a G note. And that's the same as my third string open. Now, some of you, I have a different guitar today than what I had last week that says all six gears in a straight line up here on the headstock. On the acoustic guitars, most of them have three on one side and three on the other. So you got to remember which one you're tuning. You got to follow the string up there and make sure you're grabbing the right gear. I can't tell you how many times I've sat there and turned it and nothing happened, and I look up and I'm turning the wrong one. So just be careful that you're grabbing the right one. So anyway, the fourth string G at the fifth fret, and then the third string open G. They're the same note. Now there's a pretty big difference there on an electric guitar, because on electric guitar, the third string is a plain string, and the fourth string is a wound string. And so it's going to give a little bit different quality to the sound. On the acoustic guitar, the third string is still a wound string, and the second string is a plain string. So anyway, now to review what we did so far, we did the fifth fret on the sixth string. That's the same as the open fifth string. I let them ring together so I can hear the pitch differences. Fifth fret on the fifth string is the same as the fourth string open. the fourth string, fifth fret is the same as the third string open. Here's where it's different. I'm going to play the third string is G. I'm going to play the third string G at the fourth fret, and that's a B note, and the B is the second string open. So that's the exception to our, you know, everybody thinks it's going to be the fifth fret the whole way across, but when you get to the third string, you play the fourth fret so that you can tune the second string. And again, we want to sort of try to match the pitches. Then finally, on the second string, we go back to the fifth fret on the second string. That's an E, which is the same as the first string open. So it's all a matter of just playing one note that you know is in tune and comparing it to a note that you're not so quite so sure, and then you adjust that string. At any point when I'm playing some stuff on the guitar, something doesn't sound right, I can always go back and double check everything. But remember, it all kind of started from the sixth string. So if I got one of these strings out of tune, then the rest of it also will be out of tune. So that's why it's kind of important to make sure that each one is like that. Sounding pretty good. This is called tuning by ear. It's sort of a variant of what we did last week when I played the string and you guys tried to match it at home. But like I said, that's okay if you have somebody that you know their guitar is in tune. But for instance, right, you know, when you're by yourself and you don't have another guitar, let's say your tuner doesn't work, it's always a good way to go through and get your guitar at least somewhat close to being in tune. This also helps. I don't know how many of you have noticed, and some people say if their string's really far out of tune and they turn the tuner on and they play this string and let's say it's really far out of tune and it says F and it doesn't say E, it says F. A lot of people say, well, something's wrong with my tuner. So actually, nothing wrong with your tuner. If your string's that far out of tune, it's going to tell you that you're playing whatever note you're playing. So knowing that it's Eddie 8 Dynamite Goodbye Eddie is helpful. So if I get one of my strings really, really far out of tune, and I need to use my tuner, and it's telling me that I'm playing an A note instead of a G on the third string, then I can use this method to get my string close. And once I get it close, then I can use the tuner to finally tune the whole thing. So that hopefully will help make the tuning process go a little bit smoother for you, because I know using the tuner can sometimes be confusing, and obviously doing it over Zoom is kind of tough because nobody can actually reach through the internet and turn the tuning gears for you. But it at least it can help having a reference point like that. Like any other skill that you have, if you do that each and every day, you're going to get better at it. If you never do it, it doesn't matter. It could be a year from now, it's going to still seem really kind of difficult. So what I always encourage people to do is start with that method. And again, it's 5-5-5-4-5, if you want to remember it. The quick way, 5-5-5-4-5. I tell them, go through this and see if you can spot any strings that might be out of tune. That's all. Not don't try to fix them. Just see if you can spot if there's any of them are out of tune. And then use your tuner and see if the string that you thought was out of tune, see if it's actually out of tune. It's kind of a neat way to sort of check without actually having to turn all these by ear. One other aspect of that I often tell people, don't test your ear by tuning the guitar and then seeing how close you got by using the tuner. If you take a class in physics, or more specifically acoustics, which is the study of sound, there's a lot of things dealing with harmonics and frequencies and overtones that show that our system of tuning and music is not perfect. We deal with something called equal temperament, and Pythagoras, he developed all the little triangle stuff, but he also studied ratios of strings, and his method of dividing a string into ratios those two are not the same. And so our ear averages things together. And so don't tune your guitar and then check with your tuner to see how accurate you are. Okay? So everybody got that? I know that was a sort of a question last week, and tuning is just something you get better at as you do it. Even with a tuner, it's still a machine, and you have to learn how to use the machine. But the roughing it out like that with your ear certainly makes it a little bit easier. Last week, we had a scale that I think everybody was sent a copy of that, and I believe it was emailed, and then there was also the video that was made available. But we're going to go over that real quick, and then we're going to go over the part that's at the bottom, which is an actual song. The C major scale here, what we did last week, this is for any, I don't know if there's anybody here that was here today that wasn't here last week, but just real quick, the top, there's two staves connected together here. The top one is what's called a standard notation music staff. This is the treble clef at the beginning. Most people that have had music class in school, not necessarily on the guitar, but just general music, you were probably taught what the treble clef looks like. And that top staff looks like music. That doesn't mean we know how to play it on the guitar instantly, but that's what music looks like. It's the part at the bottom here that looks a little different than most of the music you've seen. And the biggest difference right off the bat is we can see that there's six lines on this music staff instead of just five. And the other obvious difference is that it has numbers written on it instead of the notes like we have on the top. This bottom staff is called tablature. Each line on the tablature represents one string on your guitar. The top line is the first string, and the bottom line is the sixth string. So it's kind of upside down from what your guitar is, but again, the top line on the music staff is the first string, which is the one, the highest pitch on the guitar, like that. And then the bottom string down here is string number six, and that's the one closest to me. So like I said, it's kind of upside down. The numbers then indicate what frets we're going to play, like so. So if I play the first number there is the three, so I'm going to play the third fret on the fifth string. And as we pointed out last week, it doesn't, if I'm just playing one note, it doesn't matter what finger I use. I can use any finger I want. It sounds the same. The reason why fingering becomes important is because I don't just have one note to play. I've got eight of them to play. And I want to play this in a way that's going to benefit me in the future as far as, playing other things as well, and playing quickly and playing with little effort. I definitely want to learn how to do things effortlessly. If I play this whole scale with one finger, you'll notice I have to move around an awful lot. And the more I have to move around, sooner or later I'm probably going to move too far or not move far enough, and I'm going to get stuff like... It's going to sound kind of weird. And sooner or later that's going to happen. So if I get used to using all my fingers, I can be much more accurate and get a much better sound that way and not have to move nearly as much. So anyway, those notes were the third fret on the fifth string, the open fourth string, second fret fourth string, third fret fourth string. Okay, that's half the scale, do, re, mi, fa. And I always tell people it's kind of nice to sort of divide things in half just to say there's four notes. And here's the last four notes. Open third string, second fret third string, open second string, and first fret second string. Now we did that last week. Like I said, I don't know if everyone was here. There's a whole bunch of people I can't see, but I don't know if everybody was here last week. But anyway, that's just a quick little review of that. We call that the ascending form of the scale because the notes go up. They get higher in pitch, or they climb, or however you want to think of it. If I was singing along with that, the notes would get higher. If I play them completely in reverse, which is the next line on this paper, if I play them completely in reverse, totally backwards, I get the notes go lower in pitch, and always kind of explain this as sort of like being able, if you know it forwards or ascending, if you know it ascending and you know it real, real well, just can do it effortlessly and just have it memorized. If you can flip it around in your mind and do it backwards, it's a lot better than trying to memorize it backwards, because if I memorize it backwards, I got to memorize 8 more notes. If I know it ascending and I can flip it in my head, I can just do what I already know. I can just do it backwards. And I might not be able to do it as fast right now, but I can flip it around and play it in reverse, which makes the notes go lower or descend. One little interesting tidbit about descending scales is a descending major scale is it sounds like Joy to the World, the Christmas Carol. So again, we kind of identify what it sounds like so that we can pick out when things go wrong. Okay? So anyway, that's a quick little review of that C major scale. And the part at the bottom here is a somewhat famous song, I think. I know it's not everybody's favorite song or anything. Some people like it, some people don't. But it is certainly well known. And I think it's a good song to demonstrate how someone can take a scale and make a melody out of it. You know, in what's hopefully kind of an easy way to see how they actually did this, how they actually made this song. This song is written by Bill Withers. I think he's also known for that Ain't No Sunshine song, and actually quite a few others as well. But this turns out to be one of his most famous songs as well. And you can notice in the first 5 notes of the song, the first 2 notes are the same note, the 3rd fret on the 5th string, and then the next 3 are the next 3 notes of the C major scale, the next 3. So he'd use the first 4 notes in the same order that they are in the scale, and didn't do anything else with them other than just use them, just play them. Okay, now this probably brings up one of the, I guess you might say, tricks with tablature. I'm going to draw a little line right there. This brings up one of the little tricks with tablature, in that, for those of you who might have read music before, you know that this is a half note, and you also know that this is an eighth note. But if you've never read music before, you wouldn't know that, because you know you don't have that experience. And so those things are kind of important as far as a half note versus an eighth note. They tell us how long to hold the notes. Now, we're not going to try to go over all the basics of music right now at this point, because this is sort of this is the reason why people like tablature, is because they don't have to do that stuff. So real quick, I can only see about 3 people on the screen, but how many of you guys know how the Lean on Me song goes? Is anybody familiar with that song? I see one of you raising your hand, 2 of you raising your hand. Okay, so some of you know how this song goes. It's a pretty popular song. It's usually played on piano. The melody is one I think that most people recognize. If you don't know how Lean on Me goes, if I didn't know how it goes, it would be very difficult for me to sit here and read the tablature and play it and make it sound just like Bill Withers. So to be honest with you, tablature is good for playing something that you have already heard. If it's a C major scale, you all know what the C major scale sounds like. We can tell if we play the right notes or the wrong notes. It doesn't mean it's always obvious, but hopefully, you know, we'll be able to tell. If you know what Lean on Me sounds like, you can probably take these numbers, play the notes in the right order, and make it sound like the song. So one thing that music notation software does is these first 2 notes, even though they're the same, those first 2 numbers, there's some space in between them. And you can sort of judge by how much space is there in terms of how quickly or how much room you're supposed to leave in between the notes. Since they're fairly far apart, my guess is that they should be kind of spaced accordingly. So I don't want to go like this. If I do that, that doesn't exactly sound like Lean on Me. But if I space them out and... okay, starts to sound like Lean on Me. So that first note, I kind of say it was sort of by itself, and then these four are grouped together. And once again, those are the first four notes of the C major scale. Like so, okay? Then check this out. This is where it gets really kind of cool. Remember the descending part of the scale, where it just reverses itself. That's what these four notes are. Okay? So like I said, this is kind of a neat way to sort of approach learning this song. If you know what it sounds like, I can take this and make it sound like Lean on Me. We're going to go over to the next part. Now I'm circling these four, and then I notice there's a lot of space between that fourth note and then this one little open string hanging out over here, this one little zero. So I'm going to try to play it that way too, and notice that there's right here, there's two of them in a row. They're the same, but they are kind of close together. So I know that I'm not going to put a lot of space in between those two. So I'm going to play them, and then that open string hanging out at the end all by itself. Okay. If I play that entire line of music, down here at the bottom, this is another trademark of most music, I think. Most music at some point will repeat itself, and it doesn't always have a repeat sign in it, but at some point the music will repeat itself. And so what we have down here, if you notice in the second line of Lean on Me, the second line of music here, this part down here is the same as it was in the first line. They're exactly the same. Cool. That means you already know how to play it. You don't have to practice this separately. It's just the same thing you've already done, right? Then these four notes are the same as that line. Exactly the same. So I don't have to practice those separately either. I've already done those. But I get down here, and I notice that, first of all, let me do this. I'm going to group this last note over here along with it, but it's kind of hanging out all by itself again, right? That last note. These four notes, there's one note right here. I'm going to put an arrow above that. That note, that's on the second fret on the fifth string. And so right off the bat, if you know the C major scale real well, you say, wait a minute, that note's not part of that C major scale. What's that doing in there? Well, the C major scale that we learned is what's called a one octave scale. It goes from do to do. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. But the first note's do and the last note's do. So first of all, if that last note's do, then we can continue with another do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. We can actually keep going. If you have more frets on your guitar, you can go beyond that. So there's a C major scale that will cover the entire guitar. We only learned that this part down here. There's also notes that are lower than that, that are still in the key of C, but we have to go sort of descend through it. So it would be like, do, and then T, and La, Sol, Fa, and Mi. Note, which is the E note on the sixth string open. So we actually have some notes that are lower than the C major scale. So we just learned one part of it. That's where this note comes from. It comes from parts that we haven't quite done yet. And this part of the song is like so. thing, then I'm going to pull the song up here real quick and let you hear the beginning of it. I'll try to play along with it. Hopefully everybody will be able to hear that, but here's the part that we have on the page. Recognizes that now, right? That everybody understands how that works. Here's the actual song. And that's we learned that we can play right along with the piano. It's also this little sort of humming part that they're doing, and then the vocal part when it comes in. Actually fit with the song. One other thing I want to show you, this is applicable to the C major scale and also to this song, is the one thing that's sort of missing from tablature, it's a good way of notating the rhythm. And like I said, that's why you kind of have to know how the song goes if you want to play it. But as an extra test to see how well you know something when you've done played it, when you're done learning it and you're practicing it and everything, is to use a metronome. Now, they make metronomes. I have one on my phone that I like, because it has a whole bunch of presets. And I can turn the metronome on like that. And for example, the first thing I can do with the C major scale is that maybe I can play each note of the C major scale as for four clicks of the metronome. So 1, 2, 3, 4. And you can increase the speed with the metronome. It's not always about speed, but I think a lot of people get focused on speed and they think, wow, if you can play fast, that means you practiced a lot and you've really mastered something. I guess that's what the thought process is. So as you increase the speed, you become more familiar with it. Your fingers know where they're going next and you get more comfortable. So eventually I'll be able to play at that speed with one click per note, like this. 2, 3, 4. Now notice that I've been counting to four the whole time. And that's what in music what we call common time signature. And it's called that because it's the most common time signature out of all forms of music. Doesn't matter whether you like classical music or country music or jazz or rock or blues or anything. 4-4 is definitely the most common time signature. You often hear people count off songs where they go 1, 2, 3, 4. Like we said, that's sort of the most common time signature. So that's how it gets its name. In the Lean on Me song, at the very beginning, we have these 2 4s, and that's what the top number represents. The top number represents what we're going to count to when we begin the song. So the top number represents that we're going to count to 4. So if I really want to test myself and how well I know how to play Lean On Me, can I do it really, really well? It's great to be able to play along with the recording. It's also kind of cool to be able to play with a metronome. So I turn the metronome on and I find a beat and I'm going to count four and I'm going to play the song. And again, hopefully with because I know the song, I'll be able to do it with the metronome with the right timing. So 1, 2, 3, 4. If I can play with the metronome, then I know I've got it. So those are some things that you really want to, you know, hopefully set as goals. And not really so much that Lean On Me is the greatest song ever written or anything like that, but it definitely is one where you can see how somebody's used to scale that we worked on, you know, how somebody's used to scale to actually make a song, fairly popular song. There's a lot of those other examples, but I don't know that they're as popular with everyone. Like, somebody says, I only like metal. Well, there's a Judas Priest song that uses the C major scale too, but most people probably wouldn't know it, but, you know, it's a... like that. But I don't think anybody really remembers that song. But, so in case you're wondering, there's definitely way other songs, but this one just happens to be one that I think most people probably heard before, so that's why we're using this one as an example. Or if you're into Blink-182, there's some Blink-182 songs that you... Does anybody remember who Blink-182 is anymore? Nick does, but I don't know if anybody else does. Okay. So anyway, there's other songs that use this E major scale, but this is one I think pretty much everybody has heard. And it's not super, super fast either. So, it, you know, it's like a little bit of practice, you can probably do it. Okay. Everybody cool with that? Okay, well, now we're going to learn a different song, and I think Nick has this to send to you. This song is all going to be played on one string. I have to erase these lines because they're not going to match up. And we're not going to necessarily go over this whole entire thing, but we're going to go over like the first line, and you guys can all kind of work on it at home. I know it's not the world's greatest song, but it does, sort of shows people a little bit about how guitar music is written. And this one's a little more adventurous because it actually goes up to like the 7th fret and the 9th fret and stuff like that. And so we have to use these position markers to know where we are. And then we're going to show you another song after this. I'll type it in the chat for you. And some people probably know that song, especially if you've been to a Penn State football game. I think you'll know that one. But anyway, everybody's probably heard Twinkle Twinkle Little Star before. Again, I know it's not the most awesome song in the world. We'll show you how you can make it sound like all rock and roll and stuff in a second. All the notes in Twinkle Twinkle Little Star here are all played on the first string. You can see that all of them, whoops, they're all played on the first string. If you can see here at the beginning in the tablature, all of these notes are in on this top line of the music staff, so they're all going to be played on the first string. That brings up another thing about where you're looking when you're playing. I know it's always kind of a real temptation to try to look three different places. People try to look at their music on, like in this case, on the screen. Then they try to look at their left hand, and then they try to look at the right hand. And if you could actually see somebody doing this, they look at the screen, they look at their left hand, they look at their pick, then they look back here, and they look over here, and it's like you can see their heads going in circles, and it's like, it's almost like you're confusing yourself. It's like you're distracting yourself from playing well. So I always kind of say, what happens if we can get one hand to be automatic, right? What if we can get one hand to do what it's supposed to do where we don't have to look at it? Let's make it the right hand, like this. I can pick the first string over and over again, hopefully without looking at it. And I want to pick down towards the floor. I know a lot of people do this. They say, well, it's easier if I just go like this because I don't have to aim. I can just kind of go like that and pull up on the pick. And that's okay, except right now we're trying to develop a consistent technique that we do always the same every single time. And so we want to work on picking down. It's also, when we tap our foot down. And some of the things we end up doing on the guitar, when we tap the foot, it goes down and your arm goes down picking-wise at the same time. They're sort of synchronized. So that's another reason why we're trying to play all downs. So I kind of think kind of a neat exercise to do sometimes is just for like maybe 30 seconds or a minute or something, is just go ahead and pick the first string over and over and over again. And don't look at it. Just look anywhere else, but don't look at your first string. Just do it. If you hit the wrong string, you'll hear it. You can hear that it's different, and you know what happened. You know you picked the wrong string. I kind of explain it to this way sometimes. When you started playing guitar, there were six strings on your guitar. And a year from now, there's going to be six strings on the guitar. 10 years from now, there'll be six strings on a guitar. They do make some guitars that have seven strings and some that have eight, but those are I don't want to maybe say more advanced, but maybe a little more specialized. And there's a guy named Charlie Hunter has a really strange looking instrument that has fanned frets where the strings are all different lengths, but he has it for a reason. But those are very specialized uses of the guitar. Standard guitars, six strings. So if I learn where the six strings are now, I don't have to look, because, I mean, I know where the first string is, and I'm always going to know where it is. So anyway, when we go to play Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, if I can eliminate having to look at this hand, I know where it is. It's on the first string. That means all I got to do is look at the music, and I probably have to watch this hand, because I am moving around. This is a good example of a song that moves around on one string. So again, I want to find the seventh fret. You notice the first two strings are open, which is no finger. So the next two are the seventh fret. So I want to find that in advance, so I don't have to go hunting for it when it's time to play it. I don't want to go do the two zeros and say, okay, seven, let me see where is that, you know, because that takes time. So I want to get set up ahead of time. So again, I use the position markers on my guitar, 3, 5, 7. I figured out where it is. I get my finger ready. It's not on the string, but it's ready so that when I have to go like that, like so, it's already there. All I've got to do is push it down. I can sort of prepare ahead of time for that. Now, I know that seems like, how am I going to learn to play all these complicated songs if I got to prepare ahead of time? It's sort of like second nature after you do it for a while. You start playing that way. You start doing it that way all the time. It's sort of like writing on a piece of paper. You know, once you kind of get used to it and learn some basic stuff, you sort of plan out how your sentences are. You sort of write your thoughts down on paper. You don't just write words. And it's kind of the same way. You sort of just learn to sort of set it up ahead of time. So then I see that the next note, when I play the seventh fret, I see the next note's the ninth fret. Now I can do this a couple different ways. I could actually move my finger down here, play the ninth fret, and I could do that. Or I can use the spacing in my fingers to figure out where the ninth fret is. And so if this is the seventh fret, I'm going to leave my second finger right where it is, right here, and then I'm going to use my third finger to play the ninth fret because it sort of lines up. It's already lined up there, so I can use the spacing of my fingers to tell how far that note is. Now, if you got big hands, you might go, and I'm like, no, that doesn't sound like Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. That's because I stretch my fingers out too much. If you got smaller hands, you might go, you're like, no, that doesn't sound right either. So we can still use our ear to tell whether they're at the right spot or not. But anyhow, I kind of set my fingers up ahead of time, like so. And this is really kind of helpful for a lot of things. Obviously not just Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. We're just using this song as an example of how you can do this all on one string. And it has a couple things that happen. in it, so I can get prepared for those notes. In the next part of the song, I'm just going to read the numbers to you. 5-5-4-4-2-2-0. If I'm up here at the 7th fret, I don't really have access to these notes down here right now that I need. I need a 5 and a 4 and a 2. So what I'm going to have to do is I'm obviously going to have to move. And this is where the more we move, the more we have to be real, real careful. Because if I move too far or don't move far enough, I get something that doesn't sound right. So I'm going to have to move 5, 5, 4, 4, 2, 2, 0. Okay? So that whole line there is... I know it's not the world's most ultimate song or anything, but at least it's something you recognize and you can actually work on moving your hand around. And like I said, you sort of can get the habit of planting or getting prepared for your fingers ahead of time and where they're going to be playing. And it's sort of helpful. To make it sound like rock and roll, if you have an electric guitar, you turn the rock sound on like that, and you know, you can use some little pedals and stuff like that. And so, if you want to make it sound like rock and roll or something like that, so you can certainly have fun with this kind of thing. Okay, we're going to come back to that in a second. I'm going to type some things in the chat screen now. I'm hoping everybody can see this. Those are all numbers. They're numbers of notes that are numbers of frets that we're going to be playing. And we're going to play these on the 5th string. Okay? And the 5th string on your guitar is, again, Eddie 8 Dynamite Goodbye Eddie. This is the A, the 8 note. Okay? Right here. And we're going to play these notes. And hopefully... this is a song, like I said, if you've been to a Penn State football game, you probably have heard this song. If you've listened to the radio in the past 20 years or so, you've probably heard this song. It's one of those that will probably remember this little riff for a long, long time. This is what guitar players would maybe call a riff, or songwriters would probably call a riff of some sort. It's not actually the melody of the song that the person sings, but it's an instrumental part of the song that is played. It's the instrumental, you can think of it that way, it's sort of the instrumental backup melody of the song. In Lean On Me, the instruments in the song and the vocals in the song were pretty much about the same in the song. The person singing and the person people playing were doing about the same thing. In this particular song, it's not. So we're going to go up to the 7th fret. And again, when you're looking at, this is what tab kind of looks like online, sort of, when you see the text-based tabs. I don't know if any of you have ever seen that kind of stuff online, but text-based tab looks like that. It just looks like numbers. There's no standard notation. There's no half notes. There's no eighth notes. So knowing what the song is sort of helps. We're going to work on the finger position first. So it's 2 7s in a row, but that doesn't necessarily mean they're played real quickly. In fact, they're not. First one's held for a little bit longer. Then we have another 7, and a 10, and a 7, and a 5, 3, 2, 7, 7, 10, 7, 5, 3, 2. This is the good old Seven Nation Army song, or if you go to the Penn State football game, they'll call it Nittany Nation, or something like Nittany Nation Army, or something like that. But anyhow, it's a real popular old melody, and we're gonna play it on the 5th string. as you can see, I have to move around. I have to move the whole way from the 10th fret all the way down to the 2nd fret on this string, on this thing. And there's also no open strings this time. This is one of the first things we ever learned that so far that has no open strings in it. Everybody know that now? Everybody familiar with that little riff? Anyway, that's Seven Nation Army, but the band's called White Stripes. And again, if you really want to test things out, you put the metronome on and anybody know how many times in a row I just played it? 4. Okay? Just so you know. I was counting in my head. I know a lot of people count in their head. I should have counted it out loud to let you know how many times I did it. I did it 4 times in a row. In the actual song, this is an example of repetition in music. In the song, you just do it a lot of times. And everybody says, how many times do you do it? They do it 2 times at the beginning. It's just the guitar at the beginning, 2 times. I know everybody thinks it's a bass, but it's actually a guitar by the guy in the White Stripes. He just plays everything on the guitar. So it's 2 times at the beginning, all by himself, guitar only. Then the drums come in, and it's 2 more times. That's 4 total, okay? And the person didn't even start singing yet. Once they start singing, it's 8 more times. So when you play the song, just at the very beginning of the song, it's going to be 8 times in a row. Or, I'm sorry, 12 times in a row at the beginning. That's a lot of repetition, but that's how we get better at things. Play it 12 times in a row. Play it 120 times in a row. Do whatever you can. Just get really comfortable with it. When you see those people up on stage and they're jumping around and having a good time and they're playing, it's because they're comfortable playing it. It's not because they're just barely squeaking by. It's because that's second nature. They can sit here and talk while they do it. They made it up, you know. They wrote the riff, and, you know, they can sit there and talk while they're playing it. They can sing while they're playing it. That's how they're able to do that. Okay? So anyhow, that's a fun little thing. If you like that, I would maybe get a piece of paper and just write those numbers down, practice them. They're on the 5th string. If you play them on a different string, it still sounds like the right song. But the reason it does that is because the distance between each note's the same. It'll still sound okay, but if you really want to make it sound like a White Stripes, you play it on the 5th string. That's the 7th fret. Okay? Any questions about that one? All right. Now, the next thing we're going to do is real quick learn a chord. And I'm going to attempt to draw something here. It's not little stick men or anything like that. This is what we're going to see is a drawing of a guitar neck. Now, chords for most people get to be the one thing on the guitar that is probably the most difficult and the most frustrating when you're starting out, because most of the time it's more than one finger that you have to worry about, and it's also more than one note that you have to worry about. And it gets to be, a pain. OK. Okay, you guys can see all that, right? I'm hoping. Has anybody ever seen these before? These kind of things? I'm assuming, and anybody that's played guitar before probably has, but this is what you call a chord diagram. And it's like you're looking at a guitar like this. Sort of straight up and down like that. And we're looking at the part, the top line of that drawing represents the nut of the guitar, which is this white thing right here. Okay? Each one of the other horizontal lines that run straight across represents a fret on the guitar. So, like I said, it's just like you're looking at it straight on. On the right-hand side of the diagram is my first string. On the left-hand side is the sixth string. I know it's kind of written at a different angle than what you would see, but this is kind of the standard way the guitar chord diagrams are written. This particular chord has two dots there. Those dots represent where your fingers go. We have a dot on the second fret on the fifth string, so we're going to put a finger over here on the second fret of the fifth string. I'm going to use my first finger. When I started playing, every chord diagram book that I had said to use the second finger, and that's how I learned it. But I've got to be honest, after however many years of playing guitar and knowing how many songs I know, if I had to recommend now what finger to use, I would use the first finger, even though all those books will tell you the second finger. Knowing all the songs I know and all the experience I've had, that's probably what I would recommend. It's a lot what a lot of people use anyway. The first finger on the fifth string at the second fret. And then I'm going to take my second finger, and it's going to go right beside it on the fourth string at the second fret. So I've got two fingers at the second fret now. And what's kind of tricky about that is that I don't have enough room to get them both side by side, so I have to move my first finger a little bit further away, okay? And when I move that first finger a little bit further away, I'm going to have to put a little more pressure on it, because if I don't, it's going to start to get that buzzing sound. And so there's the two fingers that I need. And the next thing, at the top of the diagram, you see these little zeros, and just like in tablature, the zeros indicate an open string. So I've got a zero over here on the top of the sixth string, which means I'm going to play the sixth string open. And then I've got a zero on the third string, second string, and the first string here. So those like that, okay? So when I put my fingers down like this, I'm going to play all six strings. And when I was 9 years old, I thought this was the most awesome chord ever, because it was the only one I could make sound good, because it had all these open strings in it. This is called an E minor chord. And what I'm not sure. I'm gonna send this to Nick, and he can probably then send you the drawing of this. I can set it in chat right now. I don't know who, not everybody can get stuff through the chat screen in Zoom, but I will send it to you. What I would like you to do is I'd like you to practice this this week, just, you know, kind of getting your fingers like that, and then next week we're going to start learning some chords. Like I said, with chords, the tricky part is, like you can see, I've got two fingers that have to be in the right spot. So anyway, there's your E minor chord. And I guess we'll see you guys next week.
Okay. Hey, thank you, Jeff.
You're welcome. And I guess
have a good weekend, everybody.
Yeah, the video will be available, and Nick can send the little graphic and also the papers around and stuff.
So. Yep, I'll attach that and the twinkle page when I send the link to the recording, if anyone needs to review it, or for anybody who couldn't make it right now. So we'll get it all out, and Have a good weekend. Yep, and we'll see you next Saturday.
See ya.
All right.
I'll see you later on.
I'll see you this afternoon.
Yeah.